chose not to passively hope that someone else would bail us out. We took control of our own affairs. We decided to initiate the action. And what we accomplished together, what we have been able to accomplish thus far in these last few years, is just the start. A city is constantly being built. And that's what we're doing right now. We have the will and the confidence, but we also need to be pointed in the right direction. Our success will depend on our ability to think strategically about our future and to work together to follow that strategy. And as we ask ourselves, how can we continue our success, we have to take a look at what's happening in other cities across America. America today is enjoying a prolonged period of economic growth that is disproportionately concentrated in its largest cities. America's big cities are living in a golden age right now, fueled by major research universities, international airports, and corporate headquarters. They're home to virtually all of America's venture capital, new office construction, and foreign investment. Unemployment is negligible in these places. Real estate prices are skyrocketing, and the gap between the haves and the have-nots is just widening. These places are marked by forests of construction cranes, $50 a plate entrees, and very soon, driverless cars. Boston and New York are two of the closest examples, but there are many of them, and their seemingly unabated growth may have profound implications for the rest of America. And these days, talent tends to follow the flow of capital. The high school students who are here with you today are an accomplished group. If I ask them to raise their hands if they were interested, and when they're done with their education, to move to New York or Boston or some other big city, I suspect more than a few hands will go up. Don't raise your hands, keep your hands down. The answer is too painful, actually. But we shouldn't be surprised by the reaction. The talent drain from Greater New Bedford, from young people from Greater New Bedford is nothing new. And it's just that today the attraction in the big city is even stronger than it's ever been. So what does that mean for a mid-sized city like us that is not part of a major metropolitan area and doesn't have all the same cards to play? Well, one thing that it means is that we still have to compete. After all, we operate in the same global economy as all the major cities. And at the same time, we shouldn't see ourselves as trying to be like them or beat them at their own game. We can be something different and indeed preferable. In an America where the biggest cities are becoming more congested and expensive, and in some cases more violent, a city like ours can offer a more manageable alternative. Here and in other mid-sized cities, one can have those things that people like in urban places, really nice public spaces, walkable streets, cultural amenities, interesting architecture, and so forth, but without feeling crushed and disconnected at the same time as so many people feel in big cities. We in New Bedford don't have what people hate about big cities. Regular traffic jams, high levels of gun violence, and not knowing your neighbors. And here, you can still get a good meal at a restaurant for under 10 bucks. My point is that a city doesn't have to be a major metropolis to be successful in offering its residents an opportunity for a good life. Portland, Maine, Charleston, South Carolina are noteworthy. They're great examples of port cities. One a little bit smaller than us, one a little bit bigger than us, that are succeeding. So how do we make it happen here in our city, in New Bedford? Well, first and foremost, we must continue to focus relentlessly on making New Bedford, quite simply, a really nice place to live in. Now, this might sound like I'm just stating the obvious. Of course, everyone wants to have safe neighborhoods, more pleasant parks, cleaner streets, high-performing schools. Local government, after all, is set up to facilitate such things. But the point I'm making is that enhancing the city's quality of life shouldn't be seen simply as an end in itself, but as a means to sustaining the city in the long run. We will attract more business and excite greater civic participation and more people believe that this is a place they'd like to live in. A high quality of life is a great selling point for any city. So we've been proud of how we've been able to elevate the city's quality of life these last few years, but there's an awful lot more to do. So let's talk about those key areas. Successful cities protect the well-being of their residents. And we've made great strides on that front. Despite a spike in homicides last year that didn't fit any particular pattern, the crime rate in New Bedford is down significantly over the last few years. The reality is that the crime rate in New Bedford compares very favorably with that of other cities nationwide and in the Northeast and in Massachusetts. And that's a tribute to our officers and the leadership of our police chief, Joe Cadero. I really want to give Joe a strong shout out. But not every neighborhood is as safe as it should be, and that's the challenge before us. We are going to make every neighborhood in this city safe. So we are concentrating our attention in those areas like never before. Chief Cadero has installed new energetic leadership in the North End and South End stations that have intensified community policing efforts in the handful of areas that we need to get a better handle on. They're making their presence felt, and they're already making a difference, that we're hearing it from the neighbors. And we're putting cameras in all those areas, lots of cameras, so that we have a better chance of catching the criminals and the act and deterring further crime. I appreciate the City Council's support for financing these useful tools for our police. There will be more demands to come, but the City Council has been unwavering in their support. I really appreciate that, so thank you very much. In the next year, the police department also will become far more sophisticated in its ability to analyze crime trends. With my support, the chief will hire the department's first crime analyst and upgrade its crime mapping software so that it can be far better at predicting where crime may occur. That way, our officers can be in the right place at the right time more often. But our modernization of the police department doesn't end there. In the next several weeks, we will have the results of a year-long review of the department. It's been more than 20 years since the last review, and the last one was done in response to a lawsuit. This time, we're doing it for a different reason. We're undertaking a thorough and candid self-assessment because we want our department to go from good to great. And that will make a big difference in the everyday safety of the lives of the residents of our city. I expect many useful recommendations will come out of that report, but one of them probably will be that we should continue to target recidivism. Most criminologists would tell you that in any city, even a big one, a disproportionate amount of crime is committed by a tiny fraction of the population. It's true here in New Bedford. With that in mind, we will continue to work closely with DA Tom Quinn to devote granular attention to repeat offenders and to urge the judges in the district court to hold them accountable. We will continue to, I know everybody in the DA's office is clapping at that one, if they can hear me now. We will continue to address the roots of criminal activity as well. Chief among those efforts will be to increase the pressure on unscrupulous landlords. And you've heard this stuff from me before. But despite much improvement in this area, we still have landlords who are all too willing to allow criminals onto their properties. I have proposed to the City Council a measure that will lower the threshold for a property to be designated a so-called problem property that will allow us to shift the costs of police responses onto the property owner himself or herself, and that's exactly where it should be until those landlords actually get on the dime and actually hold their manage their properties much more closely. If they don't know by now, these landlords will eventually get the point. We will not permit them to neglect their properties in the interests of their neighbors. All of our public safety departments have been in the thick of what I believe is the most vexing public health challenge of our day, opiate addiction. Any discussion of the well-being of any city these days, including ours, has to begin there. The problem is not unique to New Bedford, but it has ended or ruined too many lives here. Our EMS and fire departments do a terrific job. Chief Gomes and Mark McGraw do fabulous work in both departments, and in fact, their departments stand out among the very best in the state, but they, like the police, are consumed with this problem. And look, it's nothing new. In fact, they will remain unwavering in their efforts to to get after this problem, because every one of those addicts is someone's son, daughter, father or mother or brother or sister. And not a single one of them ever thought they'd be in the position they're in. This is a complex and multifaceted problem that affects the people of every walk of life. So the only way we are going to turn the tide is through sustained collective effort. Our opioid prevention task force has made great strides, and I can report it that in 2017, overdoses in the city dropped some 19% over the previous year. And that's really encouraging. But there's a long way to go. I want to thank all of our first responders, public health personnel, and everyone involved in this battle now and in the days ahead. To be successful, a city must create pathways for its citizens to reach their full potential. More than anything else, that means we must offer our city's children a public school education that enables them to thrive as adults. Our schools have come a long way in these past few years because we refused to sit idly by while our kids were losing out on the education they deserved. We now have a school system that is clear in its academic goals, manages taxpayer dollars reliably, and has raised the standards for academic instruction. We have improved immensely the teaching of non-English speakers and upgraded technology and revamped the entire curriculum and have done so much more. The work has produced real results. Most notably, the state has ended its monitoring of the district, noting that it is a completely different district than it was in 2011 when the state's monitoring started. There has been a steady rise in test scores across the majority of schools and a marked rise, again, in the four-year graduation rate. New Bedford High School, in particular, under the leadership of Headmaster Coelho and the hard work of the teachers in this building, have accomplished so much. The place has been reaccredited and has seen unmistakable improvement in instruction, millions of dollars in investments in the physical plant, especially in technology, and new programs like the AP Capstone that will enable high-achieving students like the ones right around us to be more competitive in college admissions. But make no mistake, here too, the work is not done. Among other steps, the quality of instruction must continue to improve, and support for ELL and other high-need students must be beefed up. We also need to address the glaring challenge of retaining students in the district, as more and more families have chosen to send their children to other schools in the last few years. It would be simplistic to chalk up this problem entirely to helicopter parenting. The district has to do far more in the areas that make schools attractive by investing more still in facilities and managing them well, strengthening extracurricular offerings so that they again become a motivation for students to go to school, and creating an orderly but engaging culture that every student and parent wants to be part of. As the school committee goes about selecting the next superintendent, let me be really clear about one thing. There will be no relaxing of our effort to improve our schools. We are looking for a superintendent who can lead the district most effectively toward its goals, namely to offer a high-quality education to every child and to attract families to the school district. Taking the school district to the proverbial next level will require energy and persistence. It will require the building and rebuilding of relationships that are necessary to support and nurture a strong school culture. It will require the ability to connect and establish trust. For our kids in our city, we will build a school system where kids are eager to go to school in the morning, parents are proud to send them there, and teachers and principals derive personal satisfaction from the hard and important work they do. We will also continue to invest in those qualities of place that make living in New Bedford pleasant, interesting, and rewarding. We will continue to invest wisely in our public spaces and maintain the standards of excellence in the delivery of municipal services. New Bedford residents deserve nothing less. To exalt New Bedford's glorious past, we will invest in historic preservation more than ever before. And it's happening now. We have a community preservation committee poised to make its first round of funding for preservation projects that will go into the millions of dollars. To beautify our streets, clean our air, and slow down traffic, we will continue the city's most ambitious tree planting program in our lifetimes. We will make the most of our access to water by working to connect the downtown to the waterfront and begin constructing the Riverwalk with the goal of wrapping the Blue Lane up around the entire city. It's going to be fantastic and something we can all be proud of. As the city's built environment is shaped, we need robust citizen input. It's your city. You get to say how it should look. You, of course, can do that at public hearings concerning particular projects, and we certainly encourage people to come out for that. You can use the C-Click Fix app on your smartphone, and folks in DPI will tell you that I use it incessantly to call in potholes and other things on my mind. There are other ways that you can connect, and being able to connect constructively with city government is an important element of a city's quality of life. And that's why I've held monthly office hours at neighborhood libraries where people can come to talk to me about whatever's on their mind. Now, I have to say that of late, attendance at these sessions has been, shall we say, a tad underwhelming. And maybe it's the weather, I'm not sure why that is, but I really want to hear from people. And so I'm going to try something new. My plan is to draw people in the old-fashioned way, with food. In the months ahead, I'll hold office hours at various restaurants around the city, where, yes, there will be food available on my personal tab. I'm saying it with 500 witnesses in the room. And don't get any ideas, I'm not buying drinks. As many of you know, free food is an enticement that would work well on me personally. And if it heightens civic engagement just a little bit, it'll have been entirely worth it. So the message to all of you is, join me for a bite to eat and tell me what's on your mind, please. I also want to talk about another favorite subject of everyone, and that's this, money. All of our efforts to improve our city will depend on our ability to manage our finances. And our heightened bond rating reflects that we've been very effective at it, but it hasn't been easy. You've heard me say it before that the reality is that money is tight. It's very tight in the city. And we might all agree on the financial priorities, namely to sustain and improve the level of services our residents expect, invest in the city's physical plan, attract talent to city government by offering competitive salaries, fully funding our schools, and easing the burden on taxpayers. Under our current fiscal conditions, however, not all of these things can be achieved, and none of them can be achieved as well as we'd like. Now, we have made significant cuts to city government, and city government is considerably smaller and more efficient than it was 10 years ago, yet the pressure on taxpayers, especially small businesses, has only increased. And I don't need to remind an audience, this audience in particular, that high commercial tax rates do not exactly strengthen a city's competitiveness. And this is during a time of relative growth. What will happen when the national economy turns downward, as it inevitably will at some time, and state and local tax receipts start to fall? We've experienced that before. We need to be really careful not to allow ourselves to get squeezed financially. And we can't wait for a crisis to start making hard decisions. I want to make very clear to everybody here, really clear, that I will not allow our city to be put in a precarious financial position. It's happening in other cities, not too far away from here, but it's not going to happen here. The tough part is that there aren't painless options. We will continue to reorganize city government to increase efficiency, as we've done with considerable success. We'll make every effort to expand the tax base by encouraging the development of underutilized public property, and that's why the municipal golf course redevelopment project is very important. But unfortunately, these steps alone won't do the trick. Spending has to be reined in. The budget busters, as you know, are pension, health care, and charter school costs. And you've heard me criticize the state for making it difficult for municipalities to control these costs because the expenses are largely dictated by state policy. The state can fairly be said to have tied our hands. I look forward to working with the city council and the state on these matters, and I appreciate the thoughtful discussions that we've had along the way, but it is a discussion that we have to continually have as a city. A high quality of life is not possible if we are not otherwise economically competitive. It bears emphasizing that we are competing in a global economy for investment and jobs. If we don't compete effectively, they'll all go elsewhere, as our city has come to realize the hard way over the years. Growing our regional economy and the jobs that come with it requires us to focus on our competitive advantages. That is to say, we need to double down on the things that we're already really good at. In New Bedford, more than anything else, that means our maritime economy. The port is the primary economic driver of the region because it offers those competitive advantages to the various industries that call the port home: commercial fishing, recreational boating, ferry service, certain lines of international cargo, and soon enough, offshore wind. The port generates a full 2% of the state's gross domestic product and supports nearly 7,000 jobs. And as reflected in the port's strategic plan that we released just yesterday, there is potential for significant growth in the years ahead. In light of the growth and increased complexity of the port of New Bedford, yesterday we also announced that the New Bedford Harbor Development Commission, the city's port management agency under the highly effective leadership of Ed Washburn, right there, Ed. The Harbor Development Commission voted to change its name to the New Bedford Port Authority. The new name signals the leadership role New Bedford must continue to play on the East Coast, especially in fishing and offshore wind. When it comes to fishing, we will continue to assert ourselves. This past year, I testified twice before Congress on fisheries-related issues and had countless conversations with federal fishing regulators about the closure of Sector 9 and a whole host of other matters. In the last two presidential administrations, we've been in the thick of discussions about the dedication of marine monuments. They come to us. 2 years ago, we led the way in establishing the National Coalition of Fishing Communities, whose mission is to be a voice for America's fishing ports. And when it comes to the discussion around commercial fishing, New Bedford is at the table right where it should be and where it has to stay. We've also worked hard to position the port as a home for the offshore wind industry in the years ahead. Just a few years ago, there was no shortage of critics who claimed that we were putting our eggs in too many eggs in one basket, by spending so much time on offshore wind, and many thought it would never materialize. Well, it is happening, and it's happening not too long from now, and in no small part because of the political support for offshore wind that we have been able to build over the last 3 years with the help of the state legislators who are here today and so many others. All of these things, in the last few months, the state's three major offshore wind developers, all of whom have offices in the city and some of whom have tables in this room, made public bids to invest billions of dollars in wind farms off of our coast, staged right from our waterfront. We will continue to gear up for the industry's arrival on many fronts, and we're working very closely with them. And I want to thank in particular, and she couldn't be here today, Laura Douglas, the president of BCC, for the hard work that they're doing. BCC is doing to gear up for training the workforce that will come, that industry will need in the years ahead. As encouraging as these developments are, we need to continue playing our cards right. And we are entering a key phase in the long cultivation of the offshore wind industry here. And we will assist the industry however we can to settle in into the port and into the city as seamlessly as possible. We want them to succeed, and we want them to be here for a long time. And their arrival here is downright historic for the city. It'll be incumbent upon us to anticipate the industry's needs and, among other efforts, to pursue wise investments in port infrastructure to support it. At the same time, it will be important to do everything possible to ensure that the commercial fishing industry and the offshore wind industry coexist successfully in our port. Fishermen have raised legitimate concerns about safe navigation and other issues. I believe that these concerns can and must be addressed effectively so that both industries can prosper alongside one another right in our port. but it will require the offshore wind industry to be committed to an open and candid dialogue about their plans. Fishermen understand that offshore wind farms are coming, but it is also fair for them to expect that wind farms be developed the right way. And the right way here may not be the same way they were developed in Northern Europe, where the fishing industry isn't nearly as large or as complex as it is here. Federal regulations require that offshore wind developers engage in a dialogue with the fishing community. And New Bedford will be at the epicenter of where these two industries interact in the United States. There is no entity better situated than to promote this dialogue between the two industries than the New Bedford Port Authority. As the management agency for America's largest fishing port, which happens to also have a very strong record in promoting offshore wind, no one has more relevant knowledge about and credibility with both industries than the Port Authority. So today, I call upon the offshore wind developers to embrace this opportunity to work with the Port Authority to facilitate this dialogue. It will be critical to have a process in place that allows for all of the issues to be worked out. Getting it right now is critical. Let's work out those issues so that everyone who goes to sea for New Bedford can do so safely and successfully. If both of these industries expand in New Bedford, by the way, not only will we see more direct jobs, but there will be more opportunities for related innovation and entrepreneurship. This is an area to which we are devoting considerably more energy and attention. With appropriate support, marine science industries, including those associated with the expanded SMAS facility, will enable our city to attract and retain talent and further diversify our economy. And the work to grow the economy is hardly limited to the waterfront. Have you heard me say before, every successful city has a vibrant downtown. There is no exception anywhere. And now that is becoming true here in New Bedford. The downtown itself and its cultural centers like the Whaling Museum and the Citerion are enormously important economic assets, and they're doing very, very well these days. We will continue to cultivate residential development in our downtown so that these institutions can be supported appropriately and allow for more restaurants and retail to grow in our downtown and to bring more people in. It has played out that way in a number of places. It can play out here as well. And the downtown and the rest of the city will benefit from the work being done on the city's first cultural plan. Having established the state's only municipal arts fund, we will soon have a cultural plan that will enable the city's art scene to come alive like never before, and that's really exciting. And like any other city, our downtown must have strong anchor institutions. We will support our existing anchor institutions and seize every opportunity to develop or recruit new ones, whether they are government, higher education, or corporate institutions. In the years ahead, New Bedford's economy can and should benefit from improved transportation connections with other cities. Every elected official in southeastern Massachusetts over the past 20 years has advocated for the South Coast Rail Project, as has the Chamber of Commerce and so many other bodies here. And now that it appears that the alternate approach through Middleborough is gaining traction. But by and large, this is a positive development. While we in Greater New Bedford have come to appreciate that the project will not represent the economic salvation of the region as it has long been portrayed to be, the connection would offer one more good reason to live and invest here. Another important set of connections will come through our airport. Now that we can offer commercial air service, there is the potential in the years ahead for any one of us to conveniently fly out of New Bedford into the nation's airways and go wherever we want. It is indeed starting to happen, and that's really exciting. If we are to make the most of this opportunity, we have to recognize that we are running a very different airport these days, and we have to plan well. So I am announcing today that I have asked former Precise CEO David Slutz to head up a review panel to advise the city and the airport commission on how our airport can reach its full potential. The panel will be comprised of a number of business leaders, some of whom are in this room, who will work directly with a consultant to establish a long-term strategic plan which will shape the airport's operations in the years ahead. It's a major undertaking, but given the potential of our airport, it's high time that we take it on. city government will continue to work hard to help make New Bedford a stronger, more vibrant, and sustainable city. I'm eager to work with the city council to advance the city's long-term interests, and I know that they feel the same. I emphasize that in building a city, municipal government has a role to play. Government cannot do it all, and maybe not even most of it. City Hall should not be seen as the default source of the solution to every problem, however minor. It will take the collective effort of our community to make New Bedford a city that lives up to our collective aspirations. Something is expected of each one of us. The notion of citizenship is rooted in the idea that we have obligations to others. It requires more than simply expressing an opinion about what someone else should do. Being a responsible citizen requires actual action in service of collective challenges, even when it's not perfectly convenient, even when it's not easy, even when you think someone else should be doing the work. It recognizes the difference between posting a picture of a littered sidewalk on Facebook and lamenting the mess, and instead picking up the trash and throwing it away. What's expected may vary from person to person, but everyone has something to offer. If you are a business leader, we have many of you in the room here today, chances are that you have more to offer than most. Successful cities are invariably ones where business leaders own the challenge of urban renewal and work collaboratively with government toward that end. They recognize that the long-term prosperity of the city is in their personal interest and that of their organizations. They have not only the expertise and leadership skills to offer, but the resources and prestige of their organizations as well. Now, I'm not talking about charity. I want to be really clear, although that's clearly welcomed. I mean rather that if you profess a devotion to the city, there are ways to act on your devotion without unduly compromising your bottom line. And there are great examples all over the place. They are not hard to find of that kind of leadership. There are business leaders like Lynn Mastera, the CFO of Precise, who books all of her company's business visitors at New Bedford hotels unless they're full. And with a new hotel opening up soon in the downtown, there'll be more opportunities for this, and that's easy. There are those like Henry Wayner, who decided to expand his business quite substantially in the middle of the city instead of in nearby communities where it might have been a little less expensive. It's someone like Tony Sapienza, who spends countless hours pulling together business leadership through the Regeneration Committee to support and promote and propel the city's strategic priorities. And it was you, many of you in this room, including the leadership of the chamber, who spent time campaigning last year for the 4-year mayoral term because you recognized that it was in the long-term interest of the city and the entire region. Now give yourselves a round of applause for that. You deserve it. And then there are the two people who went the extra mile, about which I cannot say enough. Victor and Christine Fernandes recognized that the city should have a playground for children with severe disabilities, just like their son Noah. They knew as well as anybody that every child should have an opportunity to play outside with their peers. When we started talking about the idea, it was clear that there were various sites across southeastern Massachusetts where it could go. But Victor said to me, we really want it to be in the city. So we found a beautiful spot on Pope's Island, full view of the harbor, and we had a groundbreaking ceremony there with Noah as the star of the show. Then Victor and Christine and a mass movement known as Team Noah got down to work. They raised $1.3 million like that, and they rallied numerous businesses to promote it, to give in-kind donations, and Victor's own company, Fernandes Masonry, devoted countless hours to the construction of the playground this past fall. Unfortunately, Noah passed away before the opening of the playground that now bears his name. But what his parents and their team built for him and unknown numbers of children who struggle with severe disabilities is a testament to their devotion to those children and the city. It is the finest playground of its kind in the Northeast, if not beyond. It really is. And it will put smiles on the faces of children and families for years to come. I ask that you join me in thanking Victor and Christine for what they have done for these kids, their families, and for our city. I want you to know that your city, our city, needs you. You will find that it is well worth the effort. A city is more than a place on a map. The city shapes and frames our relationships with one another and is woven into our individual identity. It's part of who we are, past, present, and future. And when you devote your talent and your energy to make your city a better place, you've committed to improving yourself. I look forward to the work ahead with each and every one of you. Thank you, and God bless our great city.
Thank you.